Hello everyone and welcome back to another edition of the GSMC Fantasy Sports Podcast, brought to you as always by the GSMC Sports Network. My name is Christopher Shepherd. Thank you guys yet again for tuning in. On today's show, we should have a very interesting show dissecting some more fantasy football talk. We are going to be sticking with the player profiles that will come later in the show. We have some kind of nice segments where we look at different position groups and the volatility they present in terms of fantasy implications. We're going to start off with the tight end conundrum that is changing as the position revolutionizes, and also looking at how the recent rise in the wide receiver evolution can lead to rookie wide receivers making some sort of impact for their respective teams. And we're also going to be looking at how some off-season moves might impact fantasy either positively or negatively. So without further ado, let's jump right into the show. But before we even begin, I would ask that you like, follow, and subscribe to the show. It is a huge support to all of us here at the network. We also receive a ton of tips and donations, so if you do feel so inclined, please leave them at the link gsmc.cloud as it pops up on your screen. It's a huge support to both me, my fellow podcasters, and ultimately the network as a whole. So anything you leave is greatly appreciated. Also, if you have any burning questions, comments, concerns about any of my prior segments, or even some segments on today's show, you can leave them there at the link as well, and I will address them at the beginning of the next episode. But without further ado, let's jump right into what should be an interesting fantasy football heavy show. And let's start off in the realm of a very weird position group. The tight end position. Now, over recent years, the tight end position has evolved in ways that people might not even imagine. You always had kind of a top line for what a tight end position represented. You have guys like Travis Kelce, and before him a guy like Tony Gonzalez, who always sat at the top level of the tight end position. Was never truly challenged for, say, tight end one status in fantasy, or even as the title for the best tight end in fantasy football. That is not the case anymore. As the position continues to get younger, more deep, more experienced, even guys like Travis Kelce now in their mid-30s, guys like George Kittle also getting up there in age, and now younger guys like Sam Laporta, Dalton Kincaid, even Trey McBride, who's going to have a breakout fantasy campaign in my humble opinion. So, looking at the tight end position is a really intriguing way to break down something that could prove to be integral come fantasy draft time, because when you look at this position, in order to get it right, you have to understand that guys who have been in this position before, have had the experience both in fantasy and in real life, may not garner as much attention as, say, the new kids on the block. Right now, the tight end one from last season was a rookie, Sam Laporta. The tight end one who, while he did not necessarily have the best tight end one season, goes to show that in order for you to truly consider every position in a fantasy draft, you have to look beyond what the position tells you. What the position is telling us now is that tight ends are going to be a premium position in the next 2 to 3 years. Last year, for example, here's an important stat to know about what the tight end position did. In 2023, the tight ends accounted for their largest share of targets, receptions, and receiving yards ever. Looking at that stat, it's reflected in how we now have to view this crop of tight ends, because if, say, in 2024, the numbers for tight ends, the stats for tight ends, reflect those of last year, then we have to say that, okay, maybe tight ends becoming even more vital. Maybe we can't overlook this position, because in recent years, looking at tight ends was not in the top of your mind. You wanted a player who can set the tone for you, not necessarily a tight end who you might have wasted a pick on. Now, though, we're looking at a crop of tight ends where A, no longer is what one considers to be the best tight end in football right now with Travis Kelce, is not necessarily the number one overall guy in people's minds anymore, and B, a tight end position where there's very little margin for error. And so the names that I've mentioned, while they are very, very integral to how this position grows, especially guys like Sam Laporta, in order to maintain his status as someone you can rely upon, and guys like Dalton Kincaid, who last year, might I add, had the fourth most regular season receptions, these are the guys who a lot of attention will be put on. And so they need to justify that for me to fully say that the tight end position is not just a conundrum, but a dilemma where you are choosing between the perception of someone, or are you choosing between the aura of someone who you believe still has it, but might be a bit stuck in the past, and you want to look forward? Because the tight end position right now is a very forward centric position. They are looking towards the future. Some guys in this league, whether they're rookies or second-year players, are on the precipice of really, really making the tight end position a position that is a force to be reckoned with for many years to come. Now let's go to the other side of the spectrum, the more experienced guys who, while still are in this league, still are doing their thing, might be declining a little bit, and might be guys who you, as a result, can't necessarily rely upon, much like the younger guys. Travis Kelce, for example. Last year, the first time in 7 years that Kelce dropped below a 1,000-yard total, especially for someone who has developed such a rapport and connection with Patrick Mahomes, that is kind of a level of concern, is a cause for concern in terms of how important Travis Kelce has been to this Kansas City Chiefs offense. But also now that he's not necessarily going to be the most reliable player on that squad. Also, let's look at Mark Andrews. Mark Andrews is someone who's been doing this for a long time, but he has a different issue. He did have the fifth most fantasy points per game, but injuries hindered him, and he only played in 10 of them. So, as you can see, both of these tight ends are guys who, through many years, you could come to trust at the tight end position for you and not necessarily have to worry about picking up another tight end, maybe as a flex option, or rotating in and out. That's not the case anymore. Then you have a guy like George Kittle, who had a career best in yards, targets, and yards per reception, but is still in a 49ers offense that, you know, has so many other weapons to consider and develop, that he's going to fall by the wayside eventually. And so that leads to the question. Do these three core guys, who I consider to be my, at least, top three tight ends in the league, have the longevity needed where you don't have to worry about them? Or do you have to consider the fact that guys like Laporta, Kincaid, McBride, who are all up and coming, are going to be guys who can sustain you, or just be blips in the tight end spectrum of things? And so, looking at these players, right? The Laportas of the world, and the Kelces of the world. I'm thinking that there's no easy way to pick a tight end for the next fantasy football season, because of the fact that there is no middle ground. There's no one guy who bridges the gap between these younger up-and-coming guys and these guys who have established themselves in the league for many years. A lot of people might think George Kittle is that guy, but I don't think so. I think that George Kittle has proven himself to be in that upper echelon of tight ends, also Mark Andrews as well. There truly is a core three in both aspects, both with the younger guys and both with the older guys. So that dynamic really leaves me struggling to comprehend how people will view the tight end position, because it's going to be a difficult position, especially considering the fact that tight ends could potentially become a skill position group that might be the first off the board. That sounds weird to say, but you definitely don't want that position to be left to desire, mainly due to the fact that you can't necessarily find one player who's going to bridge the gap between two different worlds. And so it's going to be an interesting debate to discuss over the next couple of years, because I could be sitting here telling you this, and in 2 years' time, I could look like a fool, because either the tight end position has declined so much, or it has ascended to the point where no one's worried about this position group. And so it's ultimately up to us as fantasy managers to realize the fact that before this tight end market gets even more murky than it already is, you have to pick your poison here. You have to pick a route and stick with it and hope that it develops into something you can rely upon, because there are two divergent paths. There's two forks in the road. One represents the future and one represents the present. And whichever you choose ultimately is going to be how the tight end position is viewed for many years to come. And it's a very daunting challenge, because you kind of have to get it right in order to really truly build something in your fantasy team that stabilizes it for what your vision is. But that should just about do it for this segment. I really like this segment because it kind of dissected this entire skill position group, and I really hope you guys like it too. But coming up next, we do another deep dive into a position group, specifically the wide receiver groups, and how this young crop of rookie wide receivers can truly change and revolutionize that position in terms of fantasy. We will be right back to discuss that and more on the GSMC Fantasy Sports Podcast. I feel like I'm losing my mind. Is everybody in the world blind? Please, Lord, give me a sign, a sign. I feel like I'm losing my mind. Is everybody in the world blind? Please, Lord, give me a sign, a sign. I wanna be the greatest. Everybody on their fake shit. I look around and feel like everybody is the fakest. I make this every day and I'm impatient, hoping one day I blow up from the basement. Statement, the top is so vacant. I don't hear shit that I think is amazing. Waiting for my day when I'm playing sold out shows for 1,000 faces. Hey, give me that crown. Get in my way and you'll be put down. It ain't your place, no, this my town. If I want that shit, then I'll get it right now. I'm losing it, the noose it fits, some losing shit, a stupid myth. You choose to live or choose to dip. You choose to fight or lose your grip and lose a gift. Oh. I feel like I'm losing my mind. Is everybody in the world blind? Please, Lord, give me a sign, a sign. I feel like I'm losing my mind. Is everybody in the... Hello, everyone, and welcome back to the GSMC Fantasy Sports Podcast. I hope you enjoyed that first segment talking about the tight end position in terms of fantasy implications. But coming up next, we're going to do a deep dive specifically into how rookie wide receivers in this particular draft class can impact and revolutionize the position even more than it already has been. But before we get into that segment, I do want to remind you yet again that if you do feel so inclined, please consider leaving a tip or donation at the link gsmc.cloud. It is a huge support to both me, my fellow podcasters, and ultimately the network, so anything you leave is greatly appreciated. But without further ado, let's jump right into the wide receiver position. Now, a lot of people truly respect the wide receiver position because it's always going to be coveted, no matter which league you play in, especially if you're in a PPR league. Now, another way to view this is that NFL offenses really have keyed in on revolutionizing the passing game. Very rarely do you see them lean on a run game. There are some teams still left in the league that choose to play smash-mouth physical run the ball down your throat football. But more often than not, a lot of these teams are starting to air the ball out early and often. And it's kind of reflected in the stats, not only the stats, but in what teams are doing. Looking at the teams at the top end of the draft can really help us reimagine what the NFL is coming to. You see teams like the Cardinals, let's say. You see teams like the Giants. You see teams like the Bears really loading up on young receivers to try and figure out and, more importantly, keep up with this evolution. And so, before we dive into why these rookie wide receivers can be so impactful, I just want to do a deep dive into what the wide receiver position has already done up to this point in order to truly understand the premium we're placing on these rookie wide receivers. So, last year specifically, when you look at wide receivers, let's start with the PPR leagues, because the PPR leagues is where wide receivers truly have the chance to shine in terms of focal points of fantasy. CD last year obviously led all PPR scorers in four of the top 10 wide receivers. Now, some of you might be thinking that's a little bit low, especially for a position so highly valued in a points per receptions league. But think about this as well. Running backs also have been becoming part of the passing game, and they also can be placed at a premium, especially in a league or a type of league where wide receivers are more widely valued. And so, looking at it from that perspective, you can see why that's such an important statistic for wide receivers. Now, in terms of how wide receivers as a whole performed in fantasy, not just in PPR, 33 of them scored at least 330 fantasy points, 18 averaged 15 points per game. That's a fantastic statistic. Furthermore, 35 saw 100 targets, 27 had 1,000-yard seasons. So as you can see, those numbers can only be elevated as more and more wide receivers are entering the league in situations where they're going to see a lot of production early and often in their careers. 26 caught 7 touchdowns. 24 of the 32 teams in the NFL attempted 550 or more passes. So, therefore, needless to say, there is certainly a sense that in order to overachieve in this league, you gotta have a top-line receiver. The fact that only about 8 teams are not pass-oriented is truly a concern. And most of those teams are probably in the lower half of the league. Thus, that is why this draft was so important, and that brings us to this idea of the rookie revolution. No, I don't necessarily think that rookie wide receivers should go as high as people think, because obviously we don't yet know their potential. But in terms of how we view this draft class, and how we view the position specifically that they're entering into, then perhaps it leads us to think that potentially this rookie wide receiver class is that kind of bottom line for how the league views this. In order for the teams who are at the top end of the draft to fully buy into that, they needed these receivers to come in. And so when we in the future regard rookie receiver classes, this one specifically seems like they're in the best spot to buy into what the wide receiver position group is telling us in fantasy. And that is, more often than not, wideouts are becoming the most highly valued players in fantasy football. So let's start off with the three, in my humble opinion, who are certainly in situations where their production is going to start off very, very, very intensely. Start with Marvin Harrison Jr. the highest wide receiver taken in the draft, the Arizona Cardinals, and perhaps the wide receiver in the best situation to succeed. The Arizona Cardinals, to be honest with you, aren't necessarily a typical kind of top five team where they're either searching for a quarterback or a defensive piece to bolster one side of the ball. They're a team that already has an established quarterback. He just was injured in Kyler Murray. And they already are building something offensively, at the very least, that they believe to be stabilized. I think that this offense is definitely one of those offenses that potentially can average that 550 pass threshold. And it's going to be expected of them now with Marvin Harrison Jr. I don't necessarily know if he'll meet the lofty standards people project him to have, but he certainly offers something to the Arizona Cardinals that a couple of other rookie wide receivers aren't getting their team. He's offering a security blanket to a quarterback who they believe in their organization is the answer at the position. They're really entrusting both Kyler Murray and Marvin Harrison Jr. to figure each other out, develop that rapport that can get them into that threshold of teams that truly wish to market themselves as a pass-centric offense. And so Marvin Harrison Jr. certainly can become someone in fantasy who you can rely upon. Then we transition to someone in Malik Nabers, who is moving into a very pressure cooker environment where he's entering a team that's definitely someone that is screaming and begging for help at that position. He immediately becomes perhaps one of the best receivers the Giants have in that wide receiver room, and he immediately becomes a go-to target for a guy that also has a lot of pressure on him. And in that pressurized environment, the question will become, can Malik Nabers and Daniel Jones figure each other out as well? But this one, I kind of feel like the clock is ticking on, because Daniel Jones has proven again and again that he's not necessarily been the guy for the Giants, and this is a testing ground for how he is. Malik Nabers, we drafted him. Okay, Daniel Jones, what are you going to do? Malik Nabers, can you really help him adjust to having a guy like you? And so I think that this one is kind of hard to pin down, mainly because the New York Giants are more of a question at the offensive side of the ball than the Arizona Cardinals. And so looking at Malik Nabers is a really risky way to assess this rookie receiver class, because he could be fantastic. He could really elevate what Daniel Jones does at the QB position, get him back to at least a serviceable quarterback, and really help propel the Giants into contender status yet again. But for now, Malik Nabers is more of a question mark than Marvin Harrison Jr., because the Giants truly are a team that are struggling right now. And it's up to our interpretation whether or not we decide to trust someone like Malik Nabers. And then last but not least, Roma Dunze, who is in a much weirder situation than either of those two, where he's a rookie wide receiver with a rookie quarterback in Caleb Williams. However, the Bears have immediately come out and said that Caleb Williams will be the focal point of this offense. They immediately said, we want to throw the ball downfield. We have the personnel to do it with now. I mean, you trust that Caleb Williams is the right guy to be the Chicago Bears QB. Well, obviously, there should be pressure on Caleb Williams, because Chicago hasn't had a good franchise QB for many years. Perhaps never in their history had they had someone so promising as Caleb Williams. And so that pressure could seep in. But this also is a good situation, because Roma Dunze and Caleb Williams can progress together, whereas Malik Nabers steps into a situation where he's trying to bolster progress and Marvin Harrison Jr. is trying to sustain progress that Kyler Murray has made. And so that's why Roma Dunze and Caleb Williams are certainly going to be a tandem to watch in many years to come, especially considering the wideout position, because Caleb Williams and Roma Dunze speak to the fact that the league is transitioning. And so I would place a premium on at least looking at Romo Odunze, because he's the type of receiver that Caleb Williams can really covet. He's a guy who's going to make a lot of contested catches. He has a solid route tree, and he's someone who the Bears said, hey, we already have a fantastic skill position group. This guy can bring the extra juice. This guy's a rookie, much like who we believe is the answer at our QB position. So we just want someone who Caleb can immediately say, hey, from the same spot, let's grow together, man, get this thing done. And so Romo Odunze is certainly a name to remember. That's just about do it for this segment of today's show. Coming up next, we transition to the off-season moves that I truly believe will impact and shake up the fantasy football landscape. It should be a good segment. We'll be right back with that on the GSMC Fantasy Sports Podcast.
Looking for your daily fix of sports talk without having to pay for it? GSMC Sports Network is available on YouTube. Just search GSMC Sports Network. Get your fix of daily sports talk shows on YouTube, absolutely free. NFL, college football, NBA, MLB, MMA, UFC, fantasy football, and so much more. GSMC Sports Network has shows running all day long, with new sports shows starting every 2 hours. Just like on your favorite cable sports channel, except GSMC Sports Network is absolutely free. Just search GSMC.
Hello, everyone, and welcome back to the GSMC Fantasy Sports Podcast. We're going to continue this fantasy football discussion, continue this fantasy football talk with another segment that is a little bit more in-depth on how some coaching changes, some personnel changes are going to impact how we view fantasy football this coming year. Without further ado, let's jump into the off-season moves that I truly believe are going to shake up the fantasy football landscape. And let's start off in an interesting spot with the New England Patriots. Now, the New England Patriots obviously felt like a team that needed that change. Bill Belichick and Mac Jones certainly did not work out together, and it certainly raised questions over whether or not Bill Belichick still had longevity in this league, still could coach a stable team in this league. And so, with him gone, in steps Jerod Mayo, a guy who has completely adopted the Patriot identity, a player under Belichick, a hard-nosed guy who's really going to buy into developing this young team that has a lot of question marks. He understands the process. He understands he needs to be patient. And he's still going to preach the identity that the Patriots have built over the years under Bill Belichick and transfer it to his team that he's hoping can contend in at least 5 to 10 years. And so, looking at this New England Patriots in terms of fantasy, there's not a lot going on. Obviously, you bring in a young quarterback in Drake May, who certainly feels like the third or fourth best QB in this class. It definitely feels like he wasn't necessarily their first choice, and there's going to be a lot of pressure on him to be the right guy, because if Caleb Williams, Jaden Daniels, or even guys below him like Bo Nix start to evolve and he kind of is in the stasis where he's not improving, then, you know, questions have to be asked and the Patriots become even more of a dumpster fire. And so, looking at Drake May, I sincerely believe that you kind of have to view him as more of a flyer or streaming option if you are in a desperate situation in terms of fantasy, because I see no way, at least for 5 to 6 years, that Drake May can be viewed as a top-line fantasy player. However, he does have an interesting receiver that they brought in, Jalen Polk. He kind of got overshadowed in that Washington wide receiver room with Romo Odunze and Jalen McMillan, but he certainly has a lot of upside. He might be the most underrated receiver from that trio entering the league right now, and so I feel like in order for Drake May to have success, Jalen Polk will need to have success. And he certainly is a very savvy, intelligent player that the Patriots bring into their wide receiver room. I think he kind of fits that mold of Patriots receivers in that he's not the best at the position. He's not the fastest. He's not the most intelligent receiver. He's not the best route runner. But he's just savvy enough to buy into the Patriot identity and truly help Drake May become maybe a serviceable fantasy quarterback in future years. The player I'm probably most excited about on this Patriots squad in terms of fantasy is Ramondre Stevenson, because the Patriots, much unlike what we were talking about in the last segment, are going to be a team that is a smash-mouth physical team. It's in their nature. I think Jerod Mayo sees that in the team. That's where the strengths are. That's where the fortes are on the offensive side of the football. Ramondre Stevenson is going to be the bell cow. He's going to be someone that Drake May knows he can rely upon, whether running out of the backfield or even in the receiving aspect of the game. I think that there's going to be a lot of short to intermediate passes implemented just to get Drake May comfortable in an NFL setting. And so Ramondre Stevenson, a lot of attention should be paid to him. I think he could be in the RB 15 to 18 range. It might be a little bit of a flyer, but I think there's a lot of upside considering where this offense is at this current moment in time. They have to look at themselves in the mirror and say, okay, we have a rookie quarterback. We have a very young, kind of an experienced wide receiver room that hasn't really meshed together. But we do have a hard-nosed running back who really has, under Bill Belichick, realized what it means to be a New England Patriot. And we have to focus on that. I kind of feel like the Patriots are comparable to what the Las Vegas Raiders are right now, in that they're realizing that their strengths are their physicality. And so I think that they just have to buy into that and see where it takes them. And that's really all I can say about where this Patriots team is right now. But going to another team that definitely has a lot more excitement to them, that team right there, the Seattle Seahawks. They bring in Mike McDonald, replacing the oldest coach in the NFL in Pete Carroll with the youngest coach. And he certainly is a very defensive-minded coach. So if you're an IDP player, certainly look for Seahawks players to be steals in IDP drafts because of what Mike McDonald did at the Baltimore Ravens DC and what he brings to the Seattle position group. But a lot of questions are focused on the offense and how much control McDonald will have over that as he brings in Ryan Grubb, kind of staying in-house, the U Washington OC now coming in. And from what we hear from the Seattle Seahawks players, Ryan Grubb's offense certainly is going to be something they believe in because of the fact that Geno has come out and said, these are some plays that I've never seen before in my career. He obviously has the pedigree of leading the nation's top offense at U Washington last year in college football, but transitioning to the NFL is a different animal altogether. And so I'm really interested to see how we can develop these strong, not necessarily most consistent fantasy prospects, but how he utilizes all of them so that their best comes through. He knows that DK and Lockett are in contract years, and he knows that JSN is really looking to have a breakout season to establish himself perhaps as the wide receiver two of the future. And so the Seattle Seahawks are in an interesting position on the offensive side of the ball where I really like their fantasy prospects from what I hear, but I really have to see how they perform before they do so, because they've had so many offensive coordinators and they've had so many failures at that position in their coaching staff that there really needs to be someone who can step up and deliver for them. And so the Seahawks are kind of a question mark of a team right now in terms of fantasy. Another question mark is the Chargers, because Jim Harbaugh comes in and he is someone who, much unlike many coaches in this league, also wants to transition to a smash-mouth physical style, but he definitely has the quarterback to play fast and loose at the QB position and air the ball out. But as we see, they lose Allen and Eckler, and Jim Harbaugh wants to put a premium on the offensive line. So it certainly looks like the Chargers are going to be one of those teams that, you know, is going to take a lot of risks in terms of how they play. And so, looking at the personnel, it's really not exciting. Justin Herbert doesn't really have the receivers to throw to, and there really isn't a guy after Austin Eckler's left that really promising at the running back position. And so, the Chargers are also a huge question mark, because Justin Herbert has always been a consistent fantasy QB, but right now, it certainly seems as if Jim Harbaugh is taking his weapons away from him and really focusing on building through the trenches. And so, the Chargers are also becoming a huge question mark. But a team that's really looking promising on the other end of the spectrum is the Bears, because they're swinging for the fences and they're dying on the sword of, if this doesn't work out, then so be it, but at least we are going down swing. Caleb Williams, they drafted number one overall at the QB position. They think he's the guy to be the franchise QB, their first in their history they can truly rely upon. They added Roma Dunze as well in the draft. They brought in Keenan Allen. They have DeAndre Swift now at the running back position, and they have DJ Moore. That skill position group is very scary, and over the next couple of years, these guys could be the leading names on fantasy draft boards everywhere. Caleb could be a top 10 fantasy QB, at least in the next 3 years. Roma Dunze could also be the top end of fantasy boards in the next couple of years. And also Keenan Allen has juice in him left. DeAndre Swift is quickly becoming one of the biggest fantasy running backs. And DJ Moore is just one of those guys who always is going to add that element of verticality and the touchdown threat to any offense. And so I really think the Bears are in a stable spot that they really like. And I think that the sky's the limit for them, really. But I want to finish off with another squad who a lot of people are talking about, but I don't really think really know their true potential, just because this definitely feels like an amalgamation of stars that could work in retrospect, but nobody truly knows. That is the Washington Commanders. They bring in Dan Quinn, who has had an up and down career as a coach. Obviously, as defensive coordinator, he's worked out better. But they bring in a lot of skill position talent that's really interesting. They already have Terry McLaurin and Jahan Dotson, an exciting young wide receiver core right there. They bring in Jaden Daniels, hyper-athletic quarterback in the draft, second overall. They also bring in Austin Eckler, who's a guy who has a lengthy injury history, but can certainly add experience to that running back room, along with Brian Robinson Jr. They're going to share the burden of touches. So this Washington team is really another team, really another young team, especially, that can really grow and develop in terms of fantasy, and I'm really excited. But overall, the offseason moves that some of these teams have made either leaves them having more questions than answers, or more potential than, say, actual production. And so that's the decision people will have to make in terms of who they view and covet in terms of fantasy. Let's just about do it for this segment. Coming next, we transition to our first player profile of the day. A guy who is moving to a new team as well at the running back position, who I'm really intrigued to see in this Packers offense. That will give you a hint as to who it is, but we'll be right back with him on the GSMC Fantasy Sports Podcast.
For the best and latest podcasts available anywhere, go to the podcast app on your cell phone and type in GSMC to access free content-rich podcasts on health and wellness, book reviews, sports, entertainment, relationships, social media, movies, technology, finance, and even weird news. Subscribe and download the GSMC Podcast Network's family of shows, available everywhere podcasts.
Hello everyone, and welcome back to the GSMC Fantasy Sports Podcast, brought to you as always by the GSMC Sports Network. We are in the home stretch of today's show, and that means we are going to transition from this fantasy football discussion to my player profile for the day. And the first guy we're discussing is a guy, much like Joe Mixon from last episode, is moving to another different team, where I'm really, really interested to see how this all pans out, because that team in recent history hasn't relied on running backs as much, but I think this guy can truly help them a lot. And that guy is, drumroll please, Josh Jacobs. Josh Jacobs is one of those guys who seemingly is in decline. We saw with Las Vegas last year, he didn't necessarily have his best year, and I will show you guys the stats to prove that, but Josh Jacobs reminds me of someone who has the IQ, he has the intelligence needed to truly elevate a team that really wants to contend in this league, have proven that they can, but just needs to be trusted in. I think that's the best I can say about Josh Jacobs. But without further ado, let's jump right into his fantasy stats and why there is a sense of trepidation in him as he moves to the Green Bay Packers. So, throughout his career, he's accumulated 961.3 fantasy points, his best fantasy season being in 2022 with 275.3 points. So he's not far removed from his best fantasy season, it's just that he needs to have more consistency. Last year proved that that consistency was not going to be stabilized. With only 13 games played, he did have the 12th highest stuff rate, which is terrible, in my humble opinion, for someone, and it doesn't bode well for how he's going to play in Green Bay, but it is what it is. He was 37th in missed tackles, 44th in yards after contact, and that was actually the fewest in his career. He also had a career low in yards per carry with 3.5, so it really was not a fantastic season for Josh Jacobs, considering the fact that this 2022 was truly a year in which he established himself as a force to be reckoned with. But they are projecting him as a Green Bay Packer to really elevate his status in the league yet again. They're projecting him to have 1,075 yards rushing with 9 touchdowns, 280 receiving yards if you're a PPR fanatic. Make of that what you will. But looking at those stats, it certainly seems as if Josh Jacobs in a kind of nadir of his career. And who knows if this move to the Packers will really help him. But it certainly feels like a move that's much weirder in hindsight than people give it credit for, due to the fact the Packers are one of the lowest percentage teams in terms of how they use their running backs in terms of touches. And so they also seem to be one of those teams that are putting a premium on passing, especially because they now know what they have in Jordan Love, a guy who sat behind one of the best QBs in league history and looked like it last year, and trusting a young and experienced receiver group. And so that also goes to show the fact that maybe the Packers missed the mark with this one, because this certainly feels like one acquisition that does not make much sense. That is a caveat, and the trepidation I have in saying that I have confidence in Josh Jacobs. I think that Josh Jacobs had a remarkable season in 2022, where he made himself a force. I think that season, and it's kind of weird to say, really revolutionized the running back market and how much teams are putting a premium on running backs now, because as we saw over this past offseason, a lot of attention was being paid on the running back market and how much money they truly deserve at the running back position. And I think that season was a catalyst for that. And so, a lot of respect has to fall to Justin Jacobs for what he did for the running back position. However, right now, it certainly feels like a very risky move for a Packers team that's, for all intents and purposes, right there is one of the best in the NFC. They have the stability, they have the coach, they have the quarterback they now think they do have, and they're starting to put it all together. And I'm not saying that Josh Jacobs is going to be bad, but it certainly spells for a very weird makeup to how the Packers are going to play this out. Because let's look at the running back position for them. They already have A.J. Dillon, who's more of a workhorse back. Gone is Aaron Jones, who you definitely would consider to be a top-end fantasy running back for what he has done for them over the years. And you bring in Josh Jacobs, who has one good season to his name, and basically trust him to be the only rusher of note in a system that's looking to pass. I just don't know how the Packers are piecing this together right now. On paper, they look to be one of the most fierce passing attacks in the NFL. I think that this move certainly speaks to the fact that maybe there's doubts in the camp of whether Jordan Love can sustain that, and maybe they just wanted an insurance policy at the running back position to kind of make sure that Jordan Love can fall back on someone in the backfield and trust them with the burden as well. But Josh Jacobs just seems like a very weird guy to do it with. I know that the running back market this past offseason was very volatile, but I do think that A.J. Dillon has a lot of value there. I think that A.J. Dillon, if you do run, just get you that extra oomph. He's not necessarily going to get you the breakaway runs that you require in order to fully establish your dominance. He's not going to get yards after contact, but he's just a workhorse running back who gets the job done. Maybe on third and shorts, early downs, he just sets the tone for the Packers offense to immediately open up to what they do best. And so, adding Josh Jacobs just adds a lot of muddledness to this Packers running back room. I think he had the same profile as A.J. Dillon. I don't think he necessarily adds that much to what the Packers are going to do in the run game. But if there's any silver lining to any of this, I do think he's going to receive a ton of receiving burden. I think that that's one thing that the Packers definitely kind of need, that in order for Jordan Love to progress, they can't always be throwing the ball down the field, because he definitely needs someone who is going to go for short yardage and really allow him to open up his passing repertoire. So Josh Jacobs could be that guy. However, what does that mean for how they use him in terms of production? Because let's say A.J. Dillon is the early down back. Let's say A.J. Dillon is the tone setter. If, say, A.J. Dillon gets you 3 to 4 yards on the ground, and you're in a second and manageable situation or third and manageable situation, does that necessarily mean that Josh Jacobs can be a receiving option? Or does that mean that the Packers want Jordan Love to think, okay, we're definitely throwing the football here? Because I feel like with any young quarterback who's just entering the league, there's always a question of when and where he's going to pass, and what decisions he makes in order to process that information. Because Jordan Love certainly has the processing ability. We saw it later in the season where he truly brought everything together and an impact. And so I feel like the incorporation of a guy like Josh Jacobs into this offense really does allow Jordan Love to be a little bit more free in the way he plays, but there still is a structure to how you have to handle someone who's growing into the league. And that structure is stick with what he knows best. Will Jordan Love then be forced to say, okay, Josh Jacobs, I'm going to give you your touches? Or will he stick with what he knows, to stick with the status quo, stick with what Matt LaFleur taught him and what he has learned under a fantastic QB in Aaron Rodgers, to truly say and establish himself in the league as a fantastic quarterback? And so Josh Jacobs' value will truly stem from how he receives the football, not from how he runs, because I truly believe that A.J. Dillon is going to be the guy, the tone setter in this offense, and Josh Jacobs is just kind of used goods where he'll come in every now and then, but certainly won't get the bulk of the touches. And that is all I can truly say about this weird situation in the Packers running back room. But coming up next, we conclude today's show with one of my favorite QBs, my favorite wide receivers, from one of my favorite teams in the league, that team right there in the Seattle Seahawks. Who it is, you'll just have to tune in and find out when we come back on the GSMC Fantasy Sports Podcast. Hello everyone and welcome back to the GSMC Fantasy Sports Podcast. We are in today's last segment of the show. It's another player profile, one of my favorite wide receivers to talk about. And my favorite wide receivers on my favorite team right there, go Hawks. That is DK Metcalf. DK Metcalf has certainly had a very interesting, to say the least, fantasy career where he's always stayed in the middle of the pack consistently. But it's never truly ascended into the wide receiver top 10 discussion. And so, in this segment, I just want to dissect why that could be and why DK Metcalf, especially in a contract year, could vault himself into that status. Without further ado, let's get into his fantasy stats that prove why he is so volatile of a player. In his career, he's had 782.9 fantasy points. Obviously, his breakout season was the 2020 season where he accrued 188.3 fantasy points. But last year, however, told a really kind of ominous tale as to how DK's career might be going, especially if the Seahawks don't view him in their immediate future. He was 22nd in yards per route run, 23rd in first read share, and 20th in fantasy points per route run. And so, first downs per route run. And so, like I said, he's really in that median range of how we view fantasy wide receivers. He's not necessarily on the ascendancy, but he's not necessarily declining, so to speak, as we would say. Is it an interesting stat about him? The most interesting stat, perhaps, about any fantasy wide receiver I'll talk about on this show. He's never finished outside the top fantasy top 20 position. So, as you can see, he's always going to be in that discussion. He's always going to be at least in the top 20. But there's a reason why he's not in the top 15, not in the top 10, not in the top 5. And this segment is trying to try and figure out why. Furthermore, he was 23rd last year in PPR points per game and 17th in non-PPR points per game. So make of that what you will if you are a PPR fanatic. Last year, he did, however, have 16.9 yards per catch, which was a career high. So that also goes to show what DK Metcalf is good at. And that might be the key to unlocking why he's in this kind of weird middle ground in the fantasy wide receiver landscape. And so when I look at DK Metcalf, I look at a receiver who truly has unique skill sets that I don't necessarily believe the Seahawks have fully bought into. His strength and physicality at the wide receiver position are something that is unmatched and you can't quite teach. Also, for someone so strong and physically built, he is a very fantastic and fascinatingly good route runner as well. He does offer a lot of speed. He offers a lot of intelligence at the wide receiver position. He can get to his spots, and he does everything well. So overall, he certainly is someone who has the ability to be a well-rounded receiver. However, I definitely feel that DK Metcalf hasn't really settled into Seattle. I know it's weird to say because he's viewed as right now perhaps their number one wide receiver because of Tyler Lockett's decline as he ages. But I truly don't believe the full potential of DK Metcalf has been realized, and here's why. There's just been so much instability in Seattle in terms of how the circulation of personnel within the coaching staff, especially on the offensive side of the ball, has changed. And so DK really hasn't had the ability to learn one sort of structured way to play the position. He's had so many people in his ear talking about do this, do that, and he really hasn't had offensive structure that he can look at and say, okay, this is what I need to be doing, these are the spots I need to be hitting, and ultimately this is how I can improve as a wide receiver. And so, in order for DK to truly wish to vault into that wide receiver top 10, top 5 status, there needs to be an offensive system in Seattle that truly gets the best of his potential. And with Ryan Grubb, they could have that because there's definitely been a lot of positivity coming from the Seattle camp and how Geno Smith views Grubb as a play caller. And so we're definitely going to see if Ryan Grubb's offense lives up to its word, and especially how DK Metcalf fits into that scheme. But for now, I'm really interested in seeing how DK himself can improve, because Ryan Grubb can do everything he can to create more verbiage, more routes, more sophisticated play calling that the Seahawks have had in recent memory. But DK Metcalf has to look inward to truly become one of the best players at the wide receiver position who you want to draft in fantasy. Because right now, he's a stable bench option, but you can't necessarily call him someone who is going to get you 15, 20 fantasy points and start a new lineup week by week. And in a contract year for him as well, let's not forget that, in a contract year for him as well, where you're in a situation where Seattle could be looking to build towards the future. Mike McDonald is now the head coach. There's no more Pete Carroll. DK Metcalf certainly has to develop further than what this new coaching staff might want of him. He has a point to prove that he deserves to be one of the highest paid wide receivers in the league, perhaps, after this season. Or, you know, a trading block along with Tyler Lockett so that Seattle can start building. And so, any wide receiver in a contract year has to do more than what, you know, the organization has in place. It's a weird concept to think about because in DK Metcalf, everyone knows he has it in him. But like McDonald and Ryan Grubb don't necessarily. They're both new to this. They both know what they want, their vision for the Seahawks, and they want to implement it quickly and efficiently so that Seattle is best set up for success as contenders in the near future. And so DK has to realize that nothing is given to him in this offense. You can talk all you want about how exciting the Seattle offense could be. You can talk all you want about how Mike McDonald is going to play. But DK Metcalf certainly needs to separate himself from the pack on the offensive side of the football to gain respect in the fantasy world, because right now, wide receivers are going to be highly coveted. They're going to be coming off the board fast and quickly. The problem with DK is that some people might overvalue him, and some people might undervalue him. There's going to be no in between with DK Metcalf. DK Metcalf is either a hot commodity in your mind is someone you can see on your bench and come into your squad any given day, or he's an afterthought. And you're going to draft someone that you truly believe, A, is going to be consistent for you, and B, has the potential to go to the stratosphere and go higher than you ever thought. DK Metcalf just hasn't proven that yet. There's a middle ground, and it just seems that DK Metcalf is comfortable with being there for now. It's truly up to him to vault himself into that status. We'll have to see. There's a lot of excitement stirring in the Seattle camp about this offense, but until I see it, until I see DK Metcalf, especially in a system that could suit him more than it has in recent past years, then I'll truly be convinced of DK Metcalf's abilities. But that's just about do it for this episode of the GSMC Fantasy Sports Podcast. I hope you guys enjoyed this very fantasy football heavy episode. Remember, if you do feel so inclined, to like, follow, and subscribe to all the shows on this network. There's a lot of good things happening at the GSMC Sports Network. I've been Christopher Shepherd. Thank you guys yet again for tuning in to the GSMC Fantasy Sports Podcast, brought to you by the GSMC Sports Network. We'll be back better than ever with yet another show later on in the week. Thank you guys yet again for being such fantastic people.